Okay, so 2D or not 2D. And you're gonna hit it first. You're hoping you're gonna hit it.
Oh. Well, you don't say you don't space, right?
Yeah,
right. You don't make it.
Okay.
Okay, start again. How easy it is for your mind to go somewhere else.
Yeah.
And that's part of what I say about probably most of you weren't breathing very well. Hoping it wouldn't come to you. So we could take this in any direction. We could count the T's. So instead of T, you would say a line for the first T. There are all kinds of ways that we can make this gradually more and more difficult until you're doing something that you wouldn't have believed that you were capable of doing. And it really trains your brain to be attentive and awake, which is the point. But the point of this is to say, I wasn't there and I didn't know it. To be or not to be, that's what it means. Am I here or am I not here? It's better to be here, right? Unless you're trying to fall asleep. Can you do it again? Let's see.
Two.
So, can I do it?
Yes.
Can I do it well? Can I do it well three times in a row? That's what you're doing. So you have one, you have two more perfect ones. Ready?
All right.
Wait, what? I said T. Wait, what? Hold. Sorry.
What happened?
I missed.
Oh. But it was finished by then, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So, what happened? Was the first thing you said last
time? No, I think I messed up. Like,
not to be in.
He accidentally said T when he should have said
T. Oh, I heard.
Yeah.
Got to start in one game. But you're getting stronger. Do you feel that?
Yeah.
Are you ready?
Worse than you.
Oh.
After this, then the faculty and staff have to, no, just kidding.
Three times in a row.
Yeah.
So that's one. And you see how, you know, as you go up, I've never that scale. Can I do it? Can I do it well? Can I do it well every time? Can I do it something different? I can change the color of the ball. And then can I do it and be able to do even more than it? So this is just an example. So ready? Round two.
Okay, let's just very T O
B.
So the only flat chart, you know, those what I always was amused about is that if I ask somebody, how do you say oink, and what does a pig say in Japanese, then they would say, what does a pig say in Japanese? So it's different in every, it's the same animal that's making the same noise, but they all have a different word for it. You know, what is a cat? Mew, mew, or something.
Yeah.
So, in English, it's oink, quack. And this is great. I mean, if you're teaching children, because I would work with kids that really didn't know how to read, and they didn't know the letters, so I would start with this part. Because oink, quack, and then they get all excited. Because it's fun, oink, quack. So when you see a pig, you say oink, and then quack, oink, quack. I used to have a parrot that was in my office, and the parrot, as we drove closer and closer to the, it was called the IJ, and the parrot would start talking in the bounce tempo and saying, right, left, left, right, all the whole thing. Okay, got it? So we start from the beginning. Ready? If you're not doing that, then you can be an okay pianist, but you're not going to be a world-class pianist. And that book I mentioned, Peak, you know, talks about, you know, it depends on what your goals are. If you really want to be up there in the highest levels, then you put really purposeful practice, deliberate practice, where you're really working at another level, where you understand the object, where you have a goal, where you understand the goal, and then you understand why you didn't reach the goal, so then you work to understand why didn't you reach the goal, in other words, you're constantly upgrading your performance. And so with this, we have that possibility. If the duck is the one in the lower right-hand corner, then I want you to say the name of your favorite teacher, Dr. Ray. No. You can see some of the difference are there, just to give you more detail and the kinds of levels of attention that you can do. And those of you that came to me in vision saw how I could increase the demand of it, and you had to bring yourself back at a higher level. And you could really feel that with the balloon game, how you were really much more at a higher level than doing it. You weren't gone like you had been the first five or six tries. So anyway, that's the only quiet chart. We could just make it more and more difficult if we wanted to. We could not say anything on the ducks or any number of things. If the duck is pointing to the left, say oink. And the pigeon there, you say oink. And you just kind of keep more and more rules of the game going at the same time that I'm doing it. So let's see what we can do. How do you change this? So here's another example. I think we have numbers. Some of them are black letters on the white background and vice versa. Some of them are even numbers. I have a similar chart that is double numbers. There's some single numbers like 5 and double numbers like 12 and other numbers that are double that are like 11, 2 and 1. So you have all these different options that you can do. And what happens also, even with the on-the-quiet chart, is that you have the opportunity of changing the chart by saying, instead of going through like we would in reading it, we could go down each row. So you tend to memorize it, but then as soon as I have you do it, or had somebody do it differently, like go through it backwards, and suddenly you have to bring more of yourself to it, because now you've made it, as you go through it, it becomes easier, but all of a sudden, can I accept change? Can I still do it? But it's a different sequence. So on this one, you can do it easy, just 8, 3, 5, whatever, or you could say, whenever I get to an odd number, that's a white letter, white number on a black background, I have to add 1 to it.
Oh.
So in order to do that, you have to look ahead enough to say, what's the rule for that number and what's the answer to the number? And each time you add 1, then the next time you have to add something to another odd number of a white number on a black background, then you have to add it to the number you've already got. So 2 was the answer for the first one, and you add 1 to that one. So now the answer to that one is going to be 3. So you have to hold trains of things in your mind, sequences in your thought, as well as be able to go through the process of doing each one and making those decisions. It only works if you anticipate. If you go ahead enough that you can see what it is you're going to be doing next, and you're ready for it when the time for doing it comes. And so that gets you more present, which you really want to do as a pianist. You want to be more present, and you want to be able to anticipate. So it's that kind of a thing. So one of the ways to use this is to pick a chart or some kind of task that you do before you get ready to play, before you get ready to practice or to perform or to go to your lesson. So you say, okay, how together is my brain today? Could I do this chart? Could I have a sentence in my mind and talk, say, the first letter of the sentence and the last letter of the sentence? The boy went to school today. You know, B, the Y for today, O. So you memorize that and you say, okay, I've been doing this for a month. And I come in one day and I can't do it. So what does that mean? It means I try a couple of times, I'm not able to do this. This is not the day to be trying to do something really hard in learning something new. Today's the day I can do something that doesn't require that quite. You understand what I'm saying? It's a gauge for yourself, and for also a preparation for yourself, to be able to have something to measure yourself by, so you know where to come in. But this is the day to do something else than I thought I would do in my practice and my learning. So that's another chart. We could do something on it. But I have two other charts up here. By the way, we mentioned this book, I think, before. It's called The Fundamentals of Flow and Learning Music. Something about 30 years ago that Ms. Penny's and I put together. And it was for using this same approach, the trampoline type approach. And it starts out with an introduction to what this is all about. And you can do it on a trampoline, you can do it on one of those big physio balls, you can do it with a metronome. You just walk in place if you want. Here's a chart that I'm not going to talk about, except that it's you look at it at here, and then you it's to give you self-control, because I'm going to say, okay, this is the fish, this is the mouse, this is the duck and the bear, and then you look in here and I say bear, and you have to pause and then move to the bear. So you have to remember what's around you. And it's another way of learning kind of self-control and stay alert to what's going on in the peripheral and what you're looking at. So it's in the book. And then we have one, this is the oink quack chart, but on spades, because there's more than just oink and quack. There's apples and eyes and moons and bows and stuff like that. So it's another chart, same kind of idea. And then we have this chart, which is just sentences. And so I can say, okay, the person I would be working with, I say, okay, can you spell this while you jump? And then they say, okay, they've done it, G-I-G. So can you do it backwards? G-I-B, that's easy. Can you clap your hands on the I? Yep, I can do that. Okay, well, let's try this one. Now it's got two vowels in it. So can you clap your hands on the vowels for this one? And then there's great, which has got two vowels in a row. So I can make up something and gradually add on and on and on. And so some of you, I did the jump turn exercise in my individual classes. So here's one that I'll just show you here. Okay. So remember, you're supposed to jump and then turn and then say the next thing. Jump on the vowels. So look at this one. Okay, you got one vowel here, you got two here. Got the vowel here is at the end of the word, so that's the thing that one you've already experienced. Except, okay, and then more, excuse me, love to sail, it's got two vowels in a row. And then you have a vowel at the beginning of the word, and it's a short word, and how about A? A's a vowel. What do you do? Well, you take a bounce for the space, you take a bounce for the A, and then you turn. And what is it? Another space. Mm-hmm. So you have the silent part, so there's a really difficulty. Then you have S-E-A-O-F. So there's only a couple of, between here and here, there's only a few consonants. And so it's real, this is compared to what you did with that simple sentence. This girl, it's a much more higher level, and that's what we're looking for, is how much can we get our brain organized to be able to do things that we couldn't do a couple of minutes ago. And feel that feeling. How does it feel to do that? So we have the several of these charts are in here. And but we also have charts of reading the notes. I mean, some people who have a difficulty, you sure not any of you, but have a difficulty only how to read music, because you can't really see, it's a part of the brain that gets confused, but can't really see where the note is on the scale. And so you train that part before you actually work with the music. You train the conceptual ability. So this is that, and also to memorize the name of the note. And this is the other clef. And then there's another one. And then the bass one, so that they can't memorize it. So so this is for if you're teaching a young person or a new person, then you would start and say, okay, before we begin the lesson today, let's see if we can go through some of these so that it's not just thrown in their face, but they have a chance to build up some kind of skill that becomes really meaningful. And then we go to a little bit more difficult when they don't have the numbers, the letters of the names of the pieces. And by the way, in this one, you can do things like get a post-it, a bunch of post-it notes and cover up all the C's. So now they're going through the chart, but they can't see that it's a C. But they know it's a C, then you say, oh, that's a C. And then you do it with two of them that are covered, two of the different notes that are covered up. You understand what I'm saying? So it's a way of introducing, so they're not just suddenly blasted by all of this information that they have to internalize. You're giving them a way to learn it without that same kind of potential traumatic information. Right. So
can
then
you do that chart?
Pardon me?
Can you do that chart again?
Sure. Anyway, that is available online? No.
It is here.
Yes. So if you're interested in it. And it gets more complicated, you know, it gets where you start looking at, is this a dot? Is there two notes between this note? No. Is it a octave between this note and that note? How about the notes that are outside of it? Anyway, you understand it just gets more detailed. Okay, so this one. Okay, when you get to the black letters on the white background, don't say anything. But just take a chart, just like it was a space. Okay, ready? Every other line, you're going to not say the other color. So you go through and you have one set of instructions and then you go down to the next line. A different set of instructions and so on. So there's an infinite number of things that you can do to sharpen your mind, and be able to accept change, do it at a higher and higher level. And that's getting you really present and training your brain to be in that presence, which we all need.
Do it. Make them do it. The next song.
Okay, do it. You want to do that? Okay, you're not saying the black letters on the white, what's on the first line. And then you're not going to do the white letters on the black one, the second one, not the second one. So you're going to alternate at the end of each one. Comprende?
Okay. See.
Si. Okay, ready? To get into flow. And this one is a great one for that. You have to anticipate what's coming. So in this one, if the arrow is pointing down, then you have to do this. Down. Okay, you don't do this down. You do, or you don't do down, you have to do them at the same time. Down. So so each one we're going to do them. So let's just do the top line once, just to warm up. Okay? Ready? Okay. Ready, set, go.
Down, right, down, down, left, up.
Good. Okay, let's do both charts.
Up, left, up, right, down, left.
say the opposite and the same.
Wait, the opposite is dusted.
You guys are so sharp. Okay, so what are you going to do?
Say the same, say the same, and move on.
Say the same, and
do the opposite.
Okay, now generally I would warm people up on the top line. When you do that, we want, if you did so well, the other one could just go into it. Okay, keep it slow. What are you going to do?
Say the same, and do the opposite.
Okay, ready? One, two, three, and
down, right, down, down, left, up, should I do now?
Questions?
Have any questions? No questions. Okay.
This, what's there been a relationship to, you've been doing this for many years and you've probably seen someone who can blow your mind with their flexibility of their brain. I'm not going to ask who they are, but how are they doing now? Like, have they succeeded with their career already?
Miss Penny's did really, really well.
That's true. Okay.
No, there are people I can think of that became, you know, very good at these things. Just came in and was very good at the stuff that turned out to be very high level. Performers. So, On the other hand, if you're not so good, I mean, there's not a one-to-one correlation.
Right.
But on the other hand, if you're comparing yourself to yourself or your potential, then something that's already, like all of you people, are very good, you can get that much better. Mm-hmm. And as it points out in that Pete book that I was mentioning before, depends on when you, if you're trying to become a golfer, to become one of the, get on the most professional team of golfers, then you want to be working at your highest level, and that means that you have to be practicing a lot, you have to be doing purposeful practice, you have to understand your errors, you have to go for help if you're doing something, you say, I don't know how to do that, that's why I keep making that mistake, and then you become higher and higher. The ones that don't do that or don't spend the time, they say, okay, well, it's good enough for me to be able to play concerts around, but I'm not pirates or something that's famous and will be known after they die as something special, world class. So it depends on your goals and in your situation for you to be thinking of yourself as somebody who could succeed at a really high level. In this book, it talks about all of the different types of activities. That the main thing that stood between the people who reached the top, were classified as the top, it was 1-to-1 ratio. How much they practiced in the right way was what brought them up there, not basic talent, not the teacher, so as much as how much time did they spend doing purposeful and deliberate practice per day and to get better. So,
yeah. Do you think these exercises also strengthen like memory? Do you think that attention strength is related to memory?
Well, I think certainly in terms of learning pieces faster. Mm-hmm. You know, when you're really working, practicing, you have to put your attention really, your attention really on it. You can't be half out the door, you know, when you're doing it. Miss Penny said to me when I was working at the computer and writing, she said, I practice for strong for 10 minutes. I don't want to sit there with my brain half baked. I want to be there because I don't want to get into a habit of being there with my brain half baked. And I found that if I do it for 20 minutes or could be more than that, a little bit or less than that, then I'm really there. I'm not, then I take a break. I call somebody or I need something more. Right? And then I come back and do it because I don't want my brain to be at the piano and be half there. And that's what you're learning. So it's a great point, and I don't do it. I keep doing it. It's hard to do. It's hard to do, but it's a great habit to develop, and it's really fantastic to be able to say I'm putting all my attention there and practicing deliberately with goals that I understand, because it's going to train my brain to be better and better and better doing this. And you have to. So, I think one of the examples that was in the book was. There's a school in Berlin, I can't remember the name, that was very highly rated as a music school. And they went through it, and they classified from all the professors and other students, you know, who were the people that they thought were world class, who were the people that they thought were like were the tops but not world class, and how about the ones that were not going to be, they were going to be teaching after they finished their studies. And not really performing, you know, so there were like three or four different levels. And then they measured them in terms of how many hours, and they actually asked them first, and then they had them keep track of, you know, how long do you practice, and what do you do when you practice? And it turned out that the more they practiced in the right way, with deliberate practice and so forth, those are the ones that had come to be the top ones. I think they measured them before. They did a long study. they measured them after 4 years or 6 years, whatever it was, and they looked back and said, yeah, the ones that practiced well, you know, did it. That the boy we're talking about, they were the ones that went around town. So if there's any, born with talent, it may be that you can practice there. You know, and your practicing is, you got a little head start on it. And your parents can point you in the wrong way to not do that. Anyway, you understand what I'm talking about. So that's, I thought that was a really important point. And the way the book is written, the world would change if education really adopted this idea being able to learn in a new way. He was very excited about the fact that this could actually change how the world is. Children being trained in a different way and coming into the world with the skills and the attitudes and the adaptability and the community sense and so forth, that would change what's going on. But he talks a lot about music and piano. So anyway, I really appreciate all of you, happy to be able to participate with you, and I hope that what I've talked about has been useful and that it actually has an effect on you.